Your biscuits, so God. Okay.
This is The Artist's Response with Elizabeth Stewart, and you're welcome to join us. Please stay tuned for a program produced by Richard Dugan and researched and presented by Elizabeth Stewart, who welcomes the great artists of our community. What follows is a conversation of an artist's experience about the artist's response to trying times, creativity, reinvention, recovery, and of course, flexibility, which is in fact the narrative of our present time.
You're live.
Hello, hello, hello. This is Maggie A. in for Elizabeth Stewart. Happy Friday, everyone. You've got a three-day weekend coming up, so look lively. We'll get to that a little later on. But first, with the exodus and ruin of the big-name department stores in town, you may find yourself thinking, what did they put in the old Sears building? As of this spring, the old Sears is the new home of Moving Miss Daisy Consignment and Auction House. Moving Miss Daisy is a curated collection of consignment items that is constantly changing as inventory comes in and goes out. I'm speaking now to Glenn Novak, the owner of Moving Miss Daisy, and Louis John, who has a very fabulous high-end clothing boutique within the store. Hi, guys. Thanks for being on the show.
Hi, Maggie. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Let's start by introducing listeners to Moving Miss Daisy. What service do you provide?
Well, Moving Miss Daisy began about 8 years ago as a service to help seniors in their downsizing and relocation efforts, where we would go into their homes, do an assessment, find out what they wanted to take with them, where they were going, say to a retirement community, do floor plans of that new space, and design their new space for them, move their furniture, and then we'd go back and handle what was left. Sometimes a family or heirs would get a few pieces, and sometimes go to consignment, or we do an estate sale. We've done a couple hundred estate sales.
Oh, wow.
And what's up?
Wow. Yeah, that's great.
And so it's evolved. It actually, during, we were doing that all the way up to COVID. When COVID hit, we, the first 3 months of COVID, beginning March 16th, Louie and I and our team volunteered everywhere in town because no seniors were moving at all. It was frozen. So we were with the food bank, and Louie and I were shuttling dog food up to Santa Maria for Cares for Paws and just lots of different organizations, including picking fruit in the backyards to bring to the food bank. At the end of the 3 months, I started running out of money. So I'm like, okay, I got to do something about this. An opportunity came up to take over the old Finders Keepers store from a friend of mine, Vic Parvin. And so we did that. We took that in July 2020. Louie and I opened up that space, he with his boutique and me with consignments. And it was about 4 months into that that I realized, you know, we need a bigger space. So I've been looking for over a year, stumbled onto the Sears project in May of last year. And I was like, how do I get this started with all this space? You know, you either get 70,000 upstairs or 70,000 square feet downstairs. And so I brought in my brother-in-law, who is a car designer in town, Alain Clinet, and because I was thinking about a car museum, an event center, something that would really fill this space up, maybe combining it with consignments and art and furniture and having kind of a unique venue also. So we had some of the local car guys, including the Murphy Auto Museum, interested in potentially relocating up here. That didn't happen. The local guys were thinking, okay, we'd like it, but we have to start a nonprofit, la da 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 da. So it became more complicated. And then I had a man walk in who into our old store. He said he has a bunch of antiques to consign. I said, not quite ready. I'm looking for a larger space. And it turned out to be that he was Mattress Mike's father-in-law. And so he told son-in-law, Mike, hey, Miss Daisy is looking for a warehouse. I wasn't looking for a warehouse, but that's what he thought. So Mike called me the next day and he's like, Glenn, I hear you're looking for a warehouse. I'm looking for a space too. And so I said, well, I've got this great opportunity to move into the Sears building, but I need somebody else to help me with it. So it basically, that's what happened. You know, we took a look at it and been working on it for a few months together before we moved in on January 1st. So we're 2 months, January and February, just loading it up. And, mm-hmm. and Mike came in shortly after that. So now, excuse me, Mattress Mike and I share the entire bottom floor, which is 70,000 square feet.
Wow. It's a lovely space. I was in there yesterday checking everything out, and the collection is beautiful. I love Louis Boutique. With all, the shoes are fabulous. I can't even. Let's talk about the process. Let's say I have an armoire of particular grandeur. How would I go about consigning that to you?
Well, first of all, armoires are kind of a bad word these days.
Oh, really?
Generally, yes. Thrift shops are even turning them down, especially if you have an armoire that actually was hollowed out, excuse me, or designed for the old style televisions that maybe most viewers remember. Of a certain age, you don't, right? But those are, we can't use them for anything.
Oh, which, I see.
Barely.
What's that? I'm going to say, except for, did you want to think? I'm sorry, I'm going to.
Oh, I love my armoire as a door entrance.
Okay, so that's what I was going to get to. We actually hollowed out a big fat armoire. It was beautifully made for Louis' entrance. So you could walk through the doors. We had it at the other store. The doors were closed and people just thought it was an armoire. And then you open it up and there was like this Alice in Wonderland cave in the back with all of his clothes. It looked really cool. So he's brought here. And that's about all you can do with those big armoires. Make an archway, put it in your garden. But they're
okay. So let's say I have some other sort of furniture that you can use.
Yeah. Okay. If you're a consigner, you just you call us and say send me pictures, because it's really hard for me to drive all over town and look at any pictures. I approve of them. We set up a date for you to bring them in. And you can either bring them in and consign for yourselves or consign for a cause.
Yeah, let's talk about consign for a cause. That's something that I think sounds really beneficial to the community. Tell us how that works.
It is. I'm just delighted to share this space with the community because we have so much of it. And if need be, I can spill over into other areas too, so we can empty a full estate. But there are people in town that don't really need the income from the sale of these items, but if they want to donate it to a local consignment shop, we will give it to them. We'll give them the proceeds of the sale. We'll pick up the items for free also to make it even easier for them. It's got to be a local charity. And right now we have a few people that are working with us, such as actually two other thrift shops in town, the Assistance League and Alpha. Alpha Thrift Shop is actually over, this is brand new. This is probably brand new news for everybody. They're taking over the old Sears Automotive right upstairs from us.
Oh,
so,
okay.
So it's great. People can bring by their consignments here. And if something doesn't quite make a consignment grade, it can go upstairs. So they could also just donate directly to Alpha. But as far as going back to consign for a cause, Alpha and Assistance League are giving us items that they can't really handle in their own thrift shops because of size.
Hmm.
We have a baby grand piano here now from Alpha. And we've got three lovely pieces of original art by Dorothy Spangler that are here from the Assistance League. And we have a huge wall unit coming in for Pacific Pride. So it's just starting. We have Teddy Bear Cancer Foundation. We've had the Music Academy, where they're no longer doing those big May Madness sales. So we're getting more that people want to donate their stuff and send the money to the Music Academy.
Yeah, of course. Well, that sounds excellent. Let's take a quick break, a quick pause, but we will be back with Glenn Novak and Louis John in just a moment.
And you are clear.
Awesome.
Yeah, they talk to
just a quick break. Coffee break.
My talk. Is that okay?
You're doing fucking great.
Oh, was that recorded?
I did not have a cave. just to be clear, was not a cave.
Oh, well, I said, and also, I was thinking about Alice in Wonderland.
Yeah.
Didn't she? Help me out here. Your background looks really nice. Is that a photo?
Oh, that's Miss Thing with an A thing right there.
What shoes does Maggie want?
Ooh, I want those white platforms with all the sequins. They're not my size though.
Oh yeah, those are runway stuff.
Yeah. I need those in my life.
Oh my gosh, they're really cool. All floral and sequin, and they're awesome.
Let's see.
It's over there.
So far away.
Can't get it. But I don't want to taunt her because they're not her size.
I know. It's so sad.
I will be getting her.
Mom.
Huh?
Oh, got her headphones on. Hey, Maggie, what is the next?
So we'll talk about the inspiration for starting the store. We'll talk about a little bit about your guys' background and how that helps with running the store and your ideas for the store. We'll talk about where you source everything. And we'll just go from there. We'll talk about the auctions a little bit if you want to talk about auctions.
Talk about how.
Okay, here we go. In 3, 2, 1, you're live.
Hi, all. This is Maggie Yates in for Elizabeth Stewart. We are talking today with Glenn Novak of Moving Miss Daisy and Louis John, who has a little consignment boutique within the store. We're talking today about how the store works and how you can consign items with them and also consign for a cause, which connects people up with nonprofits so that their consignment money can go to a nonprofit. Let's talk about the inspiration for the store. What brought about this idea to start this business?
Well, Moving Miss Daisy started just as a result of everything. I come from the events world, mm-hmm. catering events, event designing for several years, and also from the auction world, catering, auction world, buying and selling antiques, tools, art, and I did that for about 8 years. And I was also became my mom's caregiver for 13 years. Hmm. And so that kind of brought me into the senior world. And my sister, Kathy Clinet, was saying, you know, Glenn, with all those skills, why don't you put them together? Because seniors really need somebody to help them transition. And so I did. And that's basically how Moving Miss Daisy was born. The store came about as a result of COVID because like I said earlier, everything kind of shut down. But even before that, I was looking for another idea other than estate sales because estate sales are basically having to liquidate everything in a day, set up the house, you know, a full week and then try to sell it all in a day. It's not the most practical way to sell. A lot of families don't want people rummaging through those estates, especially of a loved one that may have just passed. And there's a lot of liability with that when you have a couple of hundred people on your property. So the end net result for the family wasn't always great, especially because I would pull out the better stuff anyway, put them into consignment, bring them to the right auction houses. And then we would just try to liquidate what was left as part of the house. So just kept thinking there's got to be a better way. And consignment is great. Consignment and auction. This is a consignment and auction house. So, and even with the Alpha Thrift Shop upstairs or consign with the cause, we can take everything here, process it here, consign here. If there's some items that make it to the auction level, we'll put those in the auction, which will be on liveauctioneers.com. And things that don't make either one of those can go straight upstairs to the thrift shop.
Oh, to Alpha. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Now, Louis, what about you? What brought you to start your boutique?
Well, I moved here about 11 years ago from San Francisco, and my background is in the fashion industry. And I've worked at great fashion houses such as Chanel and Gucci and Vuitton and Marc Jacobs and Neiman Saks, and also done management as well in those boutiques and other small businesses. Also dabbled into real estate and interior design. And when I met Glenn, he was with Moving Miss Daisy, and I was helping him out. He asked me to help him with his, when we would do the estate sales, and we had lots of fun and met lots of great people. And then during the pandemic, when things shut down, we were doing the pet delivery of food. And then he was looking for a space, and he said, well, considering your background, what if you did a clothing portion of the store, since you know that very well? And I said, okay, that could work. Let's try it. And then we were at Hollister location, and then we opened up here.
And how do you source all of your items? Same way, through estate sales and things like that, or?
Yes. Originally, that's how it's really began. And then over the course of time, people, word of mouth, would come into the store or bring pictures, and there would be estates that would be liquidating with Glenn, and sometimes they would have a closet full of clothing. And mm-hmm. With their consent, I get to pick and choose the pieces that I like to curate my collection here for the patrons. And so it's been really great. The closets are opening up more because of the time that we're in. There's a lot of huge energy change, I believe, worldwide, and people are moving or consolidating or freshening up. So they're just opening up, letting things go and taking anew. So therefore, I'm getting all kinds of Chanel and Louis Vuitton and John and Maison Margiela. I'm getting all these great brands here. And it's really exciting to bring more of this to Santa Barbara, because fashion is art. And art is fun.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with that 100%. That's why I say I love the shoes, because the shoes are art.
Yes. And also, fashion is expression. And that's how we express ourselves, is with fashion. And this is how I feel today, or this is what I like. And it really can bring somebody's day up based on what they wear, or colors, like me.
Yeah. You look fabulous, by the way.
That's
fabulous.
So, guys, what particular niche does this fill within the Santa Barbara County community?
Well,
do you want to take that?
We have, because of the space we have, we're able to take things that normally nobody in town could take. You know, large pieces, you know, large estate pieces that come out of large homes. We have a 14-foot couch here, for example. You know, just unique pieces. And these are homes, Montecito, Hope Ranch, big homes. They're coming in and buying because they're, you know, trying to, with a big real estate boom and everybody moving to town, they're also looking for furniture, but they're having to wait 6 to 12 months for that. So they're actually buying from us, and everybody else is buying from us for the same reason. Some people buy from us just temporarily. It's like they're waiting for something to come in. I hear that all the time.
Oh, so they buy something as like a placeholder.
That's right.
Okay.
Pleasant things. Our couch won't be here for 8 months and we need something.
Right.
And they think of quality here. That's the other thing. We try to get really quality pieces of a whole bunch of different styles. I think everybody knows this. The darker furniture is not really doing so well. Small market for that, but we have a shop in the back here now where Sears used to have their sign department, sign making studio. And we're going to be carrying Annie Sloan paints, which is the inventor of chalk paint. And we have a whole big shop in the back to sand furniture and use a new technique. No, I guess not too new. It's like sandblasting, but using baking soda to blast up finishes. And then we'll repaint or restain and update really quality pieces of furniture, dressers, and, you know, dovetailed, you know, the mahogany and the cherry and the walnut pieces that people aren't, you know, going to in droves, will buy them if they're just upgraded and updated. We're going to have classes here on how to do that, on how to chalk paint. I take those now because they're just beautifully made pieces of furniture. You may not like it in mahogany, but see beyond that, and you can see our color palette with the Annie Sloan paints, and
and see, wow, that could look like this. You could do it yourself. We could do it. Then we just mark it up. But the options are here. The good furniture is here.
Yes. And as far as fashion's concerned here in the community, it's great that we don't have the fashion boutiques here per se, but the availability, we have others are, a lot of my consigners have bought things abroad and brought back some of these really specialty pieces that can be offered to our locals, which is really exciting for me and for them. There is so much response when they come in, and I'm looking forward to getting more, even more handbags are coming. And I'd like to do more of a men's kind of designer sportswear department, because there isn't a really big space for that. There are stores that sell some great fashions for men and women, but a really detailed shop here in town. There's just a few of us. So I'm really excited to tap into that more and offer that to the community. And plus the possibility, we've been talking about having a fashion show here at the store with a lot of fun music, and maybe tie it into with Glenn and the Society Jazz Band of his. He sings, I'll sing, and we'll just make a big party of it. So just to offer another outlet for our locals for fun, because Santa Barbara loves to have fun.
Absolutely. I love that idea. Let's talk more about that when we come back. We're going to take another quick break. This is Maggie Yates in for Elizabeth Stewart, KZSB. Don't go away.
Nicely done. And you're clear.
I forgot about, this is such a big place. Yeah, we do have a jazz club, and it's a venue for the nonprofits.
Yeah, we'll talk about that next. I want to hear a little bit about that.
You ever get lost in that 700,000 square foot space?
What's that?
You ever get lost?
Oh, yeah. In the beginning, we sure did. Especially when there wasn't any lights on. We're using our flashlights going upstairs and downstairs.
Well,
there's a place somewhere about upstairs and downstairs. I can feel it.
Well, these electrical bicycles here that they ride around
but little electrical bicycles just to get from point A to point B, because it's a lot of turf to cover.
I hear you there. That's pretty cool, though.
Mattress Mike has three bikes now, and they just zoom around from the back store warehouse, the loading dock, to the front of the store. I think Mike said he puts on like 44,000 steps without the bike.
Wow.
That's a lot.
Well, I'll tell you, you get too many more bicycles in there, you're going to then need traffic reports.
It's gridlock.
Traffic light. We just got a traffic light for sale.
That's right.
Yeah, but all the lights are on, so go figure.
Yeah.
Go big or go home, ladies and gentlemen. So get yourself a big space and get rid of your stuff.
One person's trash.
Would it be helpful that I actually phone and walk around the store and show while we're talking?
I don't know. That might be
probably not so much, because this being radio, even though this is video, is being recorded.
Okay.
Well, all right, we are going to be coming back. In 3, 2, 1, you're live.
Hello, welcome back. This is Maggie Yates in for Elizabeth Stewart. We're talking now to Glenn Novak and Louis John over at the Moving Miss Daisy Consignment House. We're talking now about how this huge space, which used to be the Sears building, can now be used also as an event space for nonprofits. And we're talking a little bit about the things that are coming up. So tell me more about using this space as an event space.
So because of the size of the space, and I actually have a band, I have a jazz band,
right, that
we would do like, 15, 16 gigs a year. And those gigs are no more because I had this big baby to feed. And this is, so I thought, I'm going to bring my band here. We'll put a stage up, which was over that way. And I want to have a place for consigned for the cause, for the nonprofit community, to have mixers after work, fundraisers, maybe auctions. No charge for the nonprofit to come in and use the space. We'll have a house band here, which is my band, Society Jazz. It could be other music too. We actually had interest from Santa Barbara Opera wanted to come in and do an event. Hmm. So we're going to follow up on that. We haven't actually one yet, but I wanted to have that space because I have the space. And around the stage is, first of all, it's made up of all the mannequin stages that were here at Sears.
Oh.
And there's enough. Yeah. So we just put them all together. They're stronger than any stage. And then the steps leading up to the stage are all those mirrored steps that you'd see in the old shoe department.
Right.
We just made them stairs. So it's kind of like really utilizing what was here to create the stage. We've got all the sound equipment, nice lighting in there. And when the overhead, these overhead fluorescents are off, the stage lights and all of the lamps that we have for sale are all on. And it just feels like such a great atmosphere, almost speakeasy-esque or living room, you know. It's very, very comfortable. We put a kitchen in here in the underwear and pants room. Where there was a floor sink, a floor drain in there. So, okay, this is a place we could use for a kitchen, which is my background. So we got a big 3-compartment sink, brought in some refrigeration. I have chafing dishes and that kind of thing. Just to do the basic. This is not a full wedding venue. This is for appetizers and wine venue, mixture. Sure. But I wanted to have all that in place. And some of the events that we would do, even outside of those mixtures, I'd love to have a jazz night here, Friday or Sunday jazz night. So I'm looking into getting a beer and wine license or working with one of the nonprofits where they become the benefactor, beneficiary of those, of those sales. And also having a nonprofit, it's easier to get a beer and wine license for the day. You know, so that's another little angle. Louis is going to be doing fashion shows as well. So we have fashion shows, we have jazz, we have the nonprofit mixers, we have the auctions, we have the furniture flipping in the back, consignments. Plus, I want to also mention Mattress Mike is here, so people can come here and look for new furniture. He is not just about mattresses; he sells everything, beautiful brand new furniture. Sofas, dining tables, bed sets, everything.
Okay, so it's definitely like a one-stop shop for you guys with the Mattress Mike, you guys, and then Alpha up on the top. Yeah, that's great. What a great use for the space.
We have, without even trying it, we became the biggest furniture store in at least 3 counties.
Wow.
Cool.
Well, what are some things that have come through the door that you guys were really excited about?
I like, my favorite piece still is this giant, I think probably 8-10 feet tall, railroad clock.
Oh.
Which was, we have it by the front door. We had it at the other store. It's become our mascot. It's not something for everybody's home, but it's a very cool piece. You know, it's Restoration Hardware actually did a remake of those giant clocks. You know, it's like 4-foot clock you've seen on somebody's wall. Well, this is the real thing with the whole box and everything. This would have been in a 19th century railroad depot. And now we have it. It's just such a cool piece and it works. I had a clock guy in here and he looked at it and said, oh yeah, this is working. This can work. Just showed me how to do it. I don't want to do it. It's a lot of work, but it works.
Well, one of these pieces, I know you've seen this.
Oh, is, yeah.
I'll just describe it for the radio listeners. It's a Chanel boot in pristine condition, and it actually is adorned. It's more like a military or a spat boot kind of design with the remember in the, I guess the turn of the century, they had the buckle shoes. That's what it looks like with the adorned with Chanel logo buttons, which is fabulous. Everyone comes in here and they have to see it and wish. And like, I might come back for that because it may fit me. It's a little small, but I'll do it. These kind of pieces are coming. That's one of my favorites. And there's just so much, even furniture, which is my other passion as well. And when I have that runway show, fashion show, it'll be great because all the fashions will be going down the runway with these fun local models and friends. And anybody's interested can come and check with me and we can have their runway fantasy come true. And I've been talking with a friend of mine, Deborah. She's with a local organization, and they are talking about possibly doing a fashion show tie-in for their nonprofit, possibly in October. So there's a lot of action going on here. Great pieces, lot of response to people, and Glenn and I are having fun. There's just so much opportunity to share with Santa Barbara here.
That's great. Thank you guys so much. It's been really lovely talking to you about the store and your process and everything else. Thanks for coming on.
Thank you.
Thank you, Maggie.
Thank you. Next, it's the kickoff to summer with the I Madonnari Italian Street Painting Festival, known colloquially as the Chalk Festival, this weekend at the Santa Barbara Mission. The festival is actually a fundraiser for the Children's Creative Project, which is a nonprofit that brings arts education to school children throughout Santa Barbara County. We're talking now to Kai Tepper, the executive director of the Children's Creative Project. Hi, Kai. Thanks for being on the show.
Thanks so much for having me.
Let's start by introducing everyone to the Children's Creative Project. What exactly does that organization offer?
Absolutely. So the Children's Creative Project, as you mentioned, is a nonprofit program service of the Santa Barbara County Education Office. So Kathy Corey, who is the founder, started it as actually a pilot program at Franklin Elementary School in 1974. Wow. Kathy started Children's Creative Project. She also started I Madonnari. She saw this as an opportunity to fundraise for bringing arts into schools, especially in times of need when there's been budget cuts. Interestingly enough, obviously we've been dealing with a pandemic when there's so much need for arts education because the arts feel and it brings people together. It also provides, developmental skills and provides a lot of opportunities for students to learn, self-confidence and all the good things that arts bring. So it's an important time, I think, right now, we're still in the pandemic, but coming out of the pandemic to be able to provide equitable access to arts education, especially serving those schools and students that—
I wouldn't have known.
Good, yeah. No, you're okay.
Yeah, so. Okay. So yeah, so that's a little bit of background of about Children's Creative Project.
No.
Now, where did the inspiration for this kind of event come from, the street painting, the Italian street painting?
So the story that's been shared with me is that Kathy had a friend of hers who I think had witnessed a street painting festival in Italy, which is a very old traditional, festival that stems back, hundreds of years ago. And this friend of Kathy said, this is really cool. You should go check it out. So she went to Italy, saw the community coming together in this way, and she was inspired and thought that this would be such an amazing opportunity to bring to Santa Barbara. Santa Barbara is such a wonderful place that I think celebrates the arts and values, arts of all different mediums. Obviously, it's a beautiful place here too. So the geography and landscape definitely lends itself well, I think, to being in this kind of creative space. She really is the one behind the vision of starting this street painting festival. She thought that doing it at the Mission would be a wonderful place to be able to do it. The Mission has hosted I Madonnari since its inception in 1983. So this is its 36th year. Wow. And and it's really amazing. I mean, we have a lot of artists that, are local to the area who participate year after year, but we have a lot of artists that come from all over the country, really, and if not the world. So another fun fact about I Madonnari is that it's the first of its kind in North America. So Whoa. Not only was it one of the first big festivals in Santa Barbara, but it really kind of paved the way for a lot of other street painting festivals across the country, in Canada, in Central America. There's a long-standing relationship with the Santa Barbara Puerto Vallarta Sister City Committee. And so Kathy was instrumental in starting the Puerto Vallarta Festival, Street Painting Festival. So that relationship continues. And it's exciting. This year marks the 50th anniversary between the Santa Barbara Puerto Vallarta Sister City Committee. So it's kind of an exciting moment to be able to come back to the Mission to, put on the street festival and to hopefully embark in another, 50 years of friendship with Puerto Vallarta and other cities, through the celebration of arts.
Definitely. I love that. Now, you were talking about Kathy, and she was in charge, the executive director, for like 45 years or something, right? And
correct.
You have just taken over in the last year or two, right?
Yes. So Kathy, she retired after a very fruitful, amazing career. And I will say, she's still here today helping us But it's been her baby, and she retired in August. So I stepped on, I left the Bowl, Santa Barbara Bowl, as the outreach program manager to take on this role full-time in September. So it hasn't even been a year yet officially. So I'm jumping right in.
And this is your first one in person, your first festival in person.
Correct. Yes. Yeah. So the last 2 years, Madonnari has been virtual. So, you know, unfortunately, with the pandemic, obviously mass gatherings was difficult to do. But the organization, so Children's Creative Project board and staff kind of came together and had this. And I don't know exactly whose idea it was in the first place, but they thought it'd be a great idea to be able to bring art to people's homes. So not dissimilar to, obviously there was a lot of virtual concerts happening and virtual happy hours. I think it was a really successful way to still, kind of retain this element of community building virtually by allowing artists to, make art in their driveways. The featured art, every year we have a featured artist. This year is John Morrison Wagner. And even virtually the last 2 years, Kathy worked with, local kind of contacts and friends to find really, really great spaces. So last year, the featured artist was this massive piece that several artists worked on together. And that was done at the KYT, right on top of TV Hill, which is, it's a beautiful building. This year's poster actually is a photo from last year's featured drawing. And then the year before that, I got to be someone involved because it was at the Santa Barbara Bowl.
Oh, right.
Yeah, it was done on the Overlook. So.
Oh, nice. Well, we're going to take a quick break, but when we come back, we'll be talking more with Kai Tepper about the Madonnari Festival. We'll be right back.
You're clear.
Okay. Thanks, Kai. We'll just take a quick break for commercials and stuff.
Sounds good. Can you hear me okay with my earbuds in?
I can. Richard, does she sound okay? Okay.
Sounds good. Right. Just tell the people behind you to keep down the sounds of the chalk, okay? I mean, chalk is scratching on pavement is just so irritating.
Not as bad as chalk on chalkboard, maybe. But
yeah. That's that sound. That horrible.
So yeah, I apologize. I read my email incorrectly and thought I was supposed to log on like right at 10. So when I read back, I was like, oh, I'm not on until 10:30. I'm going to run around and do something.
Yeah. No problem. It's nice to like see people pop on because then I'm like, yes, it works. Like we don't have to deal with technical difficulties.
Yes. Yeah, I'll give you kind of a sneak preview behind me.
We're
on camera, but we're getting set up. We've got artists that are starting to come out and work. It's the pavement is pretty wet. It was really wet yesterday morning as well. So we were a little frantic yesterday because we have to do, we have to snap all the lines, we have to, do all the stencils, and we had to wait until like noon. Start setting up when usually it's like first thing in the morning. So luckily we got the bulk of it done yesterday, but we showed up today and sure enough it was like wet again. So hopefully it's not this dewy.
I know
over the next couple days.
I know usually it's so hot and beautiful over the 3-day weekend. Like I'm praying for you.
All right, stand by in 3, 2, 1, you're live.
Welcome back. This is Maggie Yates. I'm here with Kai Tepper, who is running the Madonnari Chalk Festival this long weekend up at the Mission. Kai, I'm so excited to have the festival back this year. It was sort of altered during the pandemic, as you were talking about. And it's so exciting to have it back at the Mission Saturday, Sunday, Monday, all day long. Now, tell me, you were talking a little bit about the featured artists. Where do all the artists come from? Are they people in the community? Are most of them professional artists? How does that work?
That's a great question. So we have the artists that participate in Madonnari. It's a combination. I mean, they're artists of all ages, all backgrounds. Most of them are local, but some of them travel from out of town as well. So because Madonnari is a fundraiser, the way that it works is businesses will sponsor a square, and some of those businesses might have an artist that they already work with. Maybe it's somebody that, you know, is an employee for their company, or maybe it's someone's, you know, daughter or a friend. But then sponsors that maybe don't have a relationship with an artist can request that we provide an artist for them. And so we then kind of tap our network of artists. And that's a very large network, especially because our, you know, the programs that Children's Creative Project runs, beyond the street painting festival, we provide teaching art, you know, we hire teaching artists to go into the school. So we have a very wide network, you know, all across the county and beyond. So we place, on an average year, we place about 40 artists to assign them to sponsors. This year, we are assigning closer to 80 artists.
Wow.
Which is amazing. I mean, it's kind of unprecedented. We've never done that many. And I will admit, it's been a bit of a challenging year just because I think people are re-entering into this idea of festivals and public spaces and
gatherings.
Yeah. So we're actually very excited and proud of the fact that we were able to recruit that many artists. I will say that the artists that we kind of assign, a lot of them are professional artists. Many of them, we have many veterans of Madonnari who maybe started, you know, they maybe did their first chalk drawing at the first, you know, first few Madonnari festivals and fell in love with it, and which is the story of Dawn, actually, our featured artist, Dawn Morrison Wagner. So Dawn no longer lives in Santa Barbara, though she grew up here, but she drove up for the weekend to still participate. So it's a combination. We have, you know, some veteran artists who are professional that will travel, you know, year round to go to other chalk festivals, which is incredible. And you know, those who have been to the festival and see the caliber of work understand that these artists are really in demand because they're so good at what they do. We also work with a lot of the schools to bring in student artists. So we have actually a couple students from VADA, the Visual Arts and Design Academy, which I'm an alumni of. They're doing, Kathy doesn't know this yet, so hopefully she's not listening, but we're doing a surprise portrait for Kathy.
Oh!
To honor her in her kind of, you know, retirement. So we have some VADA students, we have some students from Dos Pueblos High School. There's also, you know, elementary schools that will sign up to do group squares. The Turner Foundation is another youth serving organization that I love and adore. And they've purchased a square and they're planning on bringing out some of their after school students to come in. So it's really for everyone. And beyond kind of the main plaza where we have a lot of our sponsored squares, we have a total separate kids square area that is dedicated just for kids. And those squares, you show up the day of, they're, I think, 2 foot by 2 foot. So they're smaller than the squares in main plaza.
Right.
We have chalk available for sale and you know, families will post up there all day.
Yeah.
As soon as they get their hands on chalk, they just are so immersed.
It is absolutely immersive. I full disclosure, I've been involved with the festival in the past. A friend of mine runs Out of the Box Theater Company, and we did squares.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, a couple of years in a row. And we got our artistic friends to come out, but we're theater people. We're not muralist people. So it was dicey. Our square definitely didn't look as amazing as some of the featured squares that you guys have. But we had a ton of fun doing it. It was great. And it really did. We started in the beginning of the day and all of a sudden it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And, you know, where is the day gone? You've been chalking all day.
Absolutely.
So it's a lot of fun for the community and everything else. Now, tell me about the other offerings of the festival. There's food, there's entertainment. What else is going on?
Yeah, so adjacent to the plaza where all of the chalk pieces are, we have a food and beverage kind of marketplace area. So we'll have beer and wine. We'll have, I'm looking at the setup right now. I'm describing this. I'm going in order of what I'm seeing. But we have a stage set up with you know, a whole lineup of local musicians. That lineup is available on our website under the Madonnari tab. Historically, we've run all of our booths ourselves. So we've had just these dedicated volunteers and board members who will run the sausage booth, the pasta booth, the chicken. Unfortunately, largely because of kind of pandemic related issues, we weren't able to bring back all of those vendors. So this is the first year that we actually have outside vendors that are also going to be selling in the marketplace. So we have for the first time ever a food truck, United States of Espresso. They're a new espresso truck that's parked in front of the mission every day. So they will be here. They've been my lifeline this week as I set up for the festival. We also have Rascals, which is a vegan pop-up, and then we have Dave's Dog. So, you know, I know that there's some people that are just, oh, well, what about the Italian sausage? Dave's Dogs does do an Italian sausage.
Oh, good.
but yeah, so then we have, especially with the stage area, the programming for the stage, we have, you know, music every day, Saturday, Sunday, Monday. Saturday, I'm particularly excited about because we have a number of youth bands performing. Which is great because that really ties it back to our mission of wanting to provide opportunities for students and really elevate arts education in the community. So we have Santa Barbara High School's jazz band is performing. We have the Santa Barbara Piano Boys. There are two very talented brothers who do duets. You've probably seen them around town. I have actually worked with them through Pianos on State, which is another public art project that I've been involved with for a number of years. But then we also have the Turner Foundation jazz band, which is also going to be performing.
So it's
exciting to be able to kind of bridge that too and really, again, you know, center these new voices and create, you know, an inclusive atmosphere that's both, you know, attractive to out of town visiting folks, you know, tourists, but also to really empower the local community.
That's great. Well, we're going to take another very quick break, but we will be back with Kai Tepper to talk about I'm on Nari. Don't go away.
And you are clear. And Kai, I really love the sound effects that you're using there. That sounds like a real crow too.
Oh, sorry.
No. I think it's great. It's what makes these programs so unique nowadays for the last couple of years is when people are outdoors and they get those sounds of nature and so forth. I think it's great.
Okay.
Yeah. You're on location. It's
I am on site. It's true. Yeah. One thing I should maybe mention when we get back to the break is this supplemental symposium that's happening there's a collaborative partnership that we're doing called Art of Mass Gathering.
So oh, yes. I was going to ask you about that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll talk about that when we come back. That'll be
cool.
Perfect.
Sounds good. Noticing KYT just arrived. I'm like, oh no, I did not put on makeup. I slept at 3 a.m.
You look great.
The advantage of being able to do, I can stand up in front of 5,000 people and public speak, no problem. You put me in front of a camera and I am just like, what am I saying?
Yeah, it's definitely a different experience for sure.
This is why I love radio too.
Yeah. I know I can have my like crappy background of my house and it doesn't matter.
there's just a comfortability, I guess, you know, being able to kind of not have to be, front and center in front of the camera.
Yeah.
Now I'm coming to you from my castle with no roof and it's
yeah.
And I don't have to worry about my hair. Here we go. Final segment, 5 minutes, 3, 2, 1, you're live.
Welcome back. This is Maggie Yates sitting in for Elizabeth Stewart here at KZSB. We are talking to Kai Tepper, who is the executive director of the Children's Creative Project, and they are doing the I'm on Nari Chalk Festival this weekend. Now, there's also a partnership with the Art of Mass Gatherings that's happening this weekend. Tell me about that.
Yeah, so I really believe strongly in community partnerships and collaboration. And so one of our very close partners is the San River County Office of Arts and Culture. And during the pandemic, they worked with some folks, national organizations, statewide organizations to run disaster preparedness workshops. And so through that network, there's an opportunity for this partnership to host a symposium that really looked at issues of accessibility, sustainability, climate change, and how art and festivals be used as a catalyst to really look at these kinds of areas. So Majestic Collaboration and Performing Arts Readiness, they're kind of the two primary organizations that are hosting these symposiums. And basically what they do is they find, through a big grant to the Mellon Foundation, they find festivals across the country to partner with to host a symposium and kind of turn a part of the festival into a hands-on kind of experiential learning platform. So we're excited that this Saturday we will have that partnership happening. There will be a symposium that will be taking place at a room in the event, and there's a whole agenda that covers accessibility, looking at things like how to use a solar trailer, how are your stage and your sound needs. And I think it's a really interesting conversation. Especially I think Santa Barbara is so well poised to be, having these conversations, especially being the foundation of Earth Day, and obviously we have a lot of environmentally conscious organizations here. We have such an abundance of nonprofit organizations that look at social justice issues, social services, accessibility, and so I think it's interesting to really have an opportunity to bring folks from different sectors of the event industry, whether it's artists, event producers, emergency responders, to kind of just have this conversation of what is the role that arts and events festivals play in steering best practices in these other areas. So we're very excited about that. I feel excited to think about what role Madonnari can play in working with these, especially as we try to bring it back to who we're serving as well.
Yeah, it's an interesting concept, and I'm glad that you guys are partnering with them. I mean, as you said, we do have a number of big festivals here in town, and it's nice to get a little bit of a how-to on how that works, So let's talk about, since people can come this weekend up to the Mission and check everything out, it's Saturday, Sunday, and Monday, all day long. What if people want to get involved with the festival for next year? How can they go about doing that?
That's a great question. So if people visit our website, they can go to our Madonnari tab, and you can either submit an application to be an artist. You can submit an application to be a volunteer. Folks can also reach out to me via email, and maybe they'd like to sponsor a square. Maybe they'd like to learn a little bit more about the arts education programs that we're running in the schools too. I really encourage folks to reach out and learn more about what we do, and we're very eager to partner in new ways, and as well as build upon partnerships that have already existed.
That's great. Thank you so much, Kai. It's wonderful.
Thank you.
And
thank you very much.
Absolutely. We will see you next time. This is Maggie Yates, and for Elizabeth Stewart, KZSB AM 1290, FM 96.9. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Absolutely perfect. Right on. Sorry I wasn't here for the last 2 minutes there. I got caught up. But perfect. Absolutely.
Hi, I'm Chris Cullen.
I'm Lisa Cullen.
And I'm Leanna Finley.
Our program is called Garden Gossip.
Sorry about that. I still
Thank
had the
you,
audio.
Kai.
Excellent.
No problem. Thank
More than
you
enough
so
time.
Much.
You were perfect on the out. And I really want to get together with you, Maggie, as far as talking about your publishing.
Okay, sure. Yeah, absolutely.
I don't know what your schedule is like over the next week or two, but like I said, I've got five. I actually have five chapters and an introduction. So it's like six.
I'm done in like 2 minutes.
1 week per.
Kai, you can. You're done. You can go.
Okay. Thank you both. I appreciate it.
Yeah.
Bye-bye. I'd love to do that if we can.
Yeah, let's absolutely do that. I'm pretty available. I mean, I work from home, so my availability is pretty open. So anytime you want to talk.
All right. And I don't know where you are in the area, but I'm down here, of course, on Santa Barbara and Victoria during the day. And I love going over to State Street and Starbucks on Victoria. We can
meet there if you want. Close to me. I'm just above the parks.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, I'm on Valerio.
You could always just come down here to the station. We can walk over to Starbucks and we have a little chat, and I can show you a little bit of what I'm working on if that's helpful.
That would be great. Yeah, I would love
that. Okay. I'm thinking sometime next week.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. I've got Tuesday morning open.
So every morning I have a meeting from 10 to 11, but other than that, I'm free.
Okay. What about, and I'm going to go ahead and just do this now.
Yeah.
How about around noon on Tuesday?
Tuesday around noon. Let me just check my calendar right now. I think that sounds good. Yeah, let's do that.
All right, then I will put you in here, Maggie, IE. Okay, very good. I got you in here then, and I'll make sure that this is for noon. And you want to just meet me here at the station?
Sure, yeah.
All right, then we'll go from there. Terrific. Okay, looking forward to it.
Okay, thank you so much, Richard.
Have a great weekend. Bye-bye.
Bye.